Thanks for the introduction. I want to talk today about apportioning Airbox SOA from an AMS aircraft data set, and want to discuss with you some trends that we see in both the time and in the spectra. I want to acknowledge my many co-authors from the SEECA's DC8 science team, as well as the funding agencies, especially NASA. So what is Airbox SOA, or what is Airbox SOA from an AMS perspective? So we have seen some variation of this mechanism quite a few times today and the days before. So under low NOx conditions, we photo-oxidize isoprene, we make mostly Airbox, and we think that Airbox uptakes to the particle phase under acidic conditions, often catalyzed by sulfate. And we get basically a big mixture, as Alan has shown. As Alan has shown, where you have basically a mixture of polyols, organosulfates, and probably oligomers of both of these. And the sum of all these is Airbox SOA. And as was shown first by the Manchester group a few years ago in the, from the Borneo dataset that Hugo discussed, you pretty much get a fairly reproducible spectral signature if you look at this in the AMS, with essentially this typical biogenic or BOA signature down here, and then normally two fairly specific tracers, the one at 82 and also one at 53. And this is data from Weiwei that she will show in her talk later, and I want to point out that she also sees a little bit at 75. This is something that, I mean, the chamber data typically sees those two. It doesn't necessarily see 75, and we'll discuss later maybe why that could be the case. Now, very briefly on the SEECA C3 campaigns, these were two campaigns done in 2012 and 2013, about 300 flight hours, with a very comprehensive chemical package. We had the PTIMS from the Armin Wistaller, measuring isoprene and monoterpenes. We had all the isoprene gas phase oxidation products from the Weinberg group, and for the IMRS composition, in addition to our own data, we had basically the Airbox organosulfate quantification from the NOAA PAMS instrument. And as you can see in these heat plots over on the right side, for both campaigns, I mean, even though this is really didn't specifically target the southeast, we went quite a few, quite a bit into the southeast, and we did see quite a bit of Airbox. So we're actually, you know, even coming in, kind of hopeful that we will actually see quite a bit of Airbox as well. Okay, and so I did run positive matrix factorization on every single flight for the SEECA's campaign, and you get pretty, in most of them, you get the spectral signature that I've discussed. In all, most of them, you also see a lot of 75, much more than you see in SOAS. And you know, if you tally this all up, basically from the 21 flights that we did, in 12, it's I can retrieve a spectrum that actually has the right signature, and in 10, I'm fairly certain that I'm actually separating it from other factors like monoterpenes properly, and these 10 are the ones that I'm going to discuss in the following. In itself, this is actually a pretty interesting statistical experiment, if you want, since you know this is one case where we actually doing this on the same instrument, and so any variations have to be either numerical noise or actual real data variations. And we do actually see quite a bit of variability. So if you look here at the three tracer MZs, you see that, you know, like the 53 is relatively constant, this might be numerical noise, but especially 82 and 75 are fairly variable. Okay, so what did we actually find? What is the distribution of Airbox SOA over the southeast? So here's again a heat diagram with all the valid flights, the 10 flights that I was discussing. And so if you look at the east-west distribution, green is isoprene, blue is Airbox from the Weinberg group, and red is the PMF factor average. And you see there's actually quite a bit of Airbox SOA, and it pretty much follows the Airbox profile, and this is for the east, and then the west has pretty much nothing. However, if you blow up the west, you can actually see that, you know, also there, it follows the Airbox pattern, In both cases, there's some hint that actually at high altitudes, the iapox SOE lives a little bit longer than iapox does. Now, if you put this all together, now for the actual southeast, which is this box here, you can plot this against total OA, and you get the latest is a 34% number. I would say anything between 30 and 35% is probably a pretty good estimate for the conditions that we had in CECAS, which happened to be, you know, very hot days at the end of August of last year. Now, this system has been studied many times in the lab, so I mean we have kind of a sense of what the factors are that influence them. So we would hope to see that the iapox, the SOA depends on iapox, which have seen so far a bit, that it depends on acidity, that it depends on sulfate, and we hope, since we have actually capability, it would be nice to also see that it correlates with the PALMS iapox organosulfate product. Is this actually a case? Well, if you look at the iapox as a correlation plot and not just as an altitude profile, the picture is actually quite a bit more complicated. I mean, this is not too surprising in the end, because obviously the lifetime of the aerosol is quite a bit longer than of the iapox. And so while the nice thing is that, yes, when iapox is high, we always see iapox SOE. The contrary is not true. And in fact, we see probably the highest concentrations of iapox SOE at the marginal regions where there's very little iapox left. And so this obviously would complicate any analysis where you're actually trying to look at the first steps of this mechanism. So just as an example, this is basically one flight that we did in the middle of the campaign, where we were profiling this isoprene volcano, this region of very high isoprene activity. This is the flight track as plotted as an isoprene profile, and this is actually a time trace, which is a bit complicated, so let me guide you through it. So in gray, you have basically multiple altitude profiles that we did during this flight, and then there are basically two regions to look at. One is basically where we're flying through the volcano here. In this region where we had really high isoprene, very high iapox, and then here plotted are the iapox SOE factor and the organosulfate factor, which is fairly low but correlate quite well. And then later on, we basically on the way back to Houston, we're dipping up and down. And there you have lower isoprene, lower iapox, but the aerosol concentrations are much higher. In both cases, for this particular flight, the correlation between the organosulfate and the SOA is very good. How does that actually look for the whole campaign? So we can start first with the altitude profile. This is the one you saw before. Now if I add the palms, let me do this a couple of times so you see it, so it's a black curve. You see that they all agree fairly well. Again, you could probably make the case that the palms goes away faster than the SOA does, same as the iapox. And if you look actually at the correlation plot, it's kind of the same story. So there are points of where we have high iapox organosulfate where there's almost no iapox left, but in general, it happens much more with the iapox SOA than with the organosulfate, and this might hint at this might hint that essentially the lifetime of the iapox OS is actually shorter, or might have another explanation. However, if we just focus on what we could call being close to source regions, so you know, the points above 300 ppt of iapox, we get a pretty nice correlation between the two factors of about a factor of seven or so. And what is kind of interesting is actually if you put on top of it the ionic strength calculated with the AM model from Simon Clegg, it almost seems like, as you would expect, with higher ionic strength you actually get more organosulfate. Now, how about sulfate? This is a plot now showing all points, and the good news is, whereas we only had a 31% R square for the iapox SOA versus organic, for iapox SOA versus sulfate, the R square goes up to 50%. So clearly, the sulfate has a fairly large impact, and it's just not doesn't just depend on total aerosol mass or anything like that. And similar as before, if you actually just focus on the points with a high epochs, you get a slightly nicer correlation, although you still have some variability there that we need to spend much more time analyzing and understanding. What is kind of a bust is actually when we look for acidity. I mean, it does make sense on some level. So we have one flight where the aerosol was neutralized over flying over exactly the same region as before, and there's no epochs SOA whatsoever. However, for the flights where we did, where we were able to get a PMF factor, there's very little dependence on acidity between, you know, the pHs that we see of 0 to 3 in the boundary layer. And I won't speculate right now why that is. Anyhow, I have a few minutes left, so I want to tell you a small story about the spectral variability that we see in the spectra. So this is a flight later in the campaign where we're profiling again the isoprene volcano. And this is kind of peculiar because you do see here in the epochs gas profile, you see this interesting dip at around 5,000 feet, like 1.5 kilometers. And you see the same dip as well in the palms epochs organosulfate. However, the epochs SOA is pretty much flat and seems to kind of follow sulfate. So, now the question is, why is this dip there? Well, if you look a bit at the relative humidity and especially at the cloud prop data, it becomes pretty obvious that this is actually the typical height where the boundary layer clouds were sitting. And so most likely this is really just uptake to the mid-level clouds. What is really interesting is if you keep cranking the PMF, you can actually split the PMF, AMS factor into two that actually pretty much intersect at this height. So, and you get basically one factor that is at cloud, above cloud, and one below cloud. And I mean, obviously these two layers are very different, and this could be many different things, but you know, it is kind of suggested that this happens right around the clouds. It might really be that the uptake is happening in the cloud droplet. And very briefly, looking at a spectra, the amazing thing is how similar they are. You really have to go to, you know, the O2C ratio is very similar. You really have to look a bit fairly close in the correlation plot, and you will find that mostly what gets enhanced is CHO, methoxy, and again, our good friend MZ75. And then this is a completely different flight, 3 weeks before, different spot, same vertical layering, same split in the factors, same O2C, and same ions. And again, a healthy enhancement in the 75. So that seems, you know, the AMS is a fairly blunt instrument, but you do have some of these ions, I think, are telling us something. And, you know, this might hint really at a different formation mechanism that we normally believe it is. So, and since I'm almost out of time, I'll leave the conclusions there. I want to mostly point out that yes, we have about 35% contribution of epochs SOA to the total burden. I didn't show you anything of the DC3 campaign. That's mostly because the PMF analysis is not finished. But based on the preliminary analysis, it's pretty much the same story. It's just everything is about a third lower, I guess because we're in spring instead of in summer. And finally, I wanted to say that this variability in the factor, I think, kind of probably complements what Alan was showing with the different molecular composition of what we call epochs SOA. And thank you very much.
We have time for a question.
We did have clouds almost always. We normally see it when we had enough altitude profiling. So
I mean, let me put it this way. So far, I have only seen it when you have this funny structure in the IO box. It's kind of hard to say because pretty much you're averaging over a 3-hour period, and yes, there will always be some cloud there. So question is, how do you define, what's the threshold for enough cloud?